Well, all right, guys and gals, it's my pleasure to welcome a long-term friend of the Survival Podcast and expert council member, Dr. Ken Berry, to the Survival Podcast. Ken, welcome back to the show, man.
Thanks, Jack. Always a pleasure to chat with a rational, intelligent human.
Well, we'll see if we can find one for you, but until then, I'll do my best. Let's start out with, just for people that maybe are tuning into the show for the first time, they haven't heard from you, they don't know who or what a Dr. Ken Berry is. Tell us, like, you know, the condensed version of your story of how you've come to the work you're doing now.
Yep. I'm traditionally trained MD in allopathic medicine, went to state university, graduated middle of my class, did a residency in family medicine, and started practicing medicine both in the emergency room and in the clinic, and started getting fat. We were, Jack and I were just talking, before our early 30s, we were great. We were muscly, we were skinny. Then all of a sudden, mid-30s, I got fat and I got pre-diabetic and I got a whole host of other medical conditions. And so I thought, well, okay, I give advice on this every day, right, Jack? I'm an expert. And so I started applying the advice I was giving to my obese diabetic patients. Eat lots of whole grains, drink fruit smoothies, eat lots of fruits and vegetables, go jogging, eat less and move more. And so I did that for 3 months and I actually gained more fat and got more pre-diabetic. And it was at that point I said, what the hell? I don't understand. And so that's when I really put back on my thinking cap and my student hat and stopped and took off my expert hat, because obviously I wasn't an expert because I didn't know what the hell I was talking about, did I? And so I basically went back to school and got a idiosavant education in nutrition and just, you know, autodidact, and just started reading everything I could get my hands on. And it kind of became obvious that if you're overweight and pre-diabetic or type 2 diabetic, you need to be eating a very low carbohydrate diet. And indeed, when I started doing that, the pounds of stored fat started falling off and the hemoglobin A1C went back to normal very quickly. And so then I started recommending that to my patients. At some point on this journey, my wife said, you know, you help 30, 40 patients a day in the clinic. That's awesome. I'm proud of you. But what if you could help 3,000 people a day? And that's when she said, you should start a YouTube channel. Initially, I was very resistant to that. I'm like, I'm a doctor. I'm board certified, blah, blah, blah. Why would I be a YouTube? And then I finally just shut up and listened to my wife, which Jack knows from experience, usually turns out for your benefit. And I listened to my wife and started a YouTube channel, and here we are.
So did you, in this journey, kind of discover what I did, that, like, I started my journey on this with like the work of the Dr. Zeeds on protein power, Atkins, kind of old school low carb, and it worked, but it was not sustainable. I would not stick to it. I would fall off it. Yep. And when I discovered keto and said, hey, you know, fat is your friend. And I agree with a lot of people in our world to say, do not fear protein. Like, people that think protein's all going to turn to sugar, it's like, that's an on demand. Your body has to take what it wants to do gluconeogenesis with. It's not going to take more than it needs, right? But the fat, it made everything sustainable, because all of a sudden you weren't trying to, like, gnaw the knees off of a donkey while it ran down the street in the middle of the day because you weren't hungry anymore. And to me, that was like the magic final link, that it wasn't that I was afraid of fat on those diets. I wasn't getting enough because I wasn't consciously seeking it.
Right. Yep. And I think that's very common. And so let's just be honest right up front. If you energy restrict, you can lose weight on any diet. But the problem with every diet in the world that is a calorie restriction or a portion control diet is that it is, by definition, a semi-starvation diet. And Jack has animals on his farm. I've seen them. If you starve your ducks enough, Jack, they'll go over the fence, won't they?
They absolutely will. Sure.
I used to have goats. If I underfed them, after a day or two, they would get out of the fence. I don't care. You could have a prison type wall fence situation. The goats would get out if they're hungry. Guess what? Human beings are mammals too. We're exactly the same. When a doctor tells a patient, okay, you need to semi-starve yourself for the rest of your life, and that will fix your obesity and your diabetes, that's like telling the patient, hey, you should just hold your breath for 30 minutes a day, just all at one time, get it out of the way. That's impossible. Or say, you know, you should make your heartbeat 20 beats a minute. Well, I can't. What are you talking about? So telling a patient you should move more and eat less, that is the definition of semi-starvation, is it not?
It is. And I actually think it's kind of worse, because by not telling them to change the food they're eating, let's face it, you were there, I was there, some of these people are way worse than we were at our worst. You become addicted to carbohydrates. So when you tell somebody, well, you can eat pasta and grains and even donuts if you check your sugars and do whatever you're supposed to do, you know, and adjust your insulin, the complete lie. But you're also telling the crack addict, look, man, or the heroin addict, you don't need to stop your crack or your heroin. You just need to use less of it, right? And then imagine that you can go to any store, anywhere, anytime, any place, and buy as much crack and heroin as you want. And you give somebody that's an addict the advice to just use less drugs.
Yeah,
you're killing them. And that's what these doctors are doing. I know you feel the same way.
100%. Yeah. And I think the best advice for people who are addicted to crack is, come on, you just got to
stop using crack.
No. Just smoke crack in moderation, Jack. That's
which is what they're saying, isn't it? Isn't that exactly what they're saying? You've got somebody that's 350 pounds. They have arms where the fat rolls over their elbow. They've been eating donuts and pasta their whole life. You say eat less of them. Like, what are the odds that will ever, under any circumstances, work? I would say almost zero.
0%. And that's why, indeed, the regulatory bodies that govern medicine are starting to just recommend gastric bypass surgery, even for children with morbid obesity. They're like, guys, just stop wasting your time recommending this move more, eat less, because the patients aren't going to do it. We won't talk about the fact that that shit don't work. But the patients aren't going to do it. So just go straight to gastric bypass. Just chop out part of their gastrointestinal system, mutilate their guts, and that'll help them lose weight. Just cut to the chase and stop recommending this and that and lifestyle modification. And it's the reason that doesn't work is because you're telling the crack addict, just smoke crack in moderation, bro. Don't stop overdoing it on the crack. And I was talking to
Narcan, right? Take your Narcan daily and you'll be good.
Yeah, take your Narcan. And so I was just talking to my friend Melissa about a keto website that's very popular. She was making a recipe for peach cobbler. Now, Jack, do you love peach cobbler?
I love it, but I don't eat it.
Dude, I freaking love it. But she said in her video, you can have peach cobbler on keto. You just have to eat it in moderation. And I'm like, oh, that's revolutionary advice. Okay, so just have it in moderation. You're telling all the carb addicts to just smoke their crack in moderation. So I think that's the main reason a lot of people, if they've tried keto and failed, it's because they were either eating lots of things that they were just trying to eat in moderation and obviously failing every time because they're a carbohydrate addict, or they were using lots of keto products like the exogenous ketones and the keto cookies and pies and cakes and shakes and bars. That's never going to work. You can do this with real food. You can do this without buying a single product. And that's why I love it so much. And as Jack alluded to earlier, it's super sustainable when you're adding enough fat to make your food delicious and to help your body get all the essential fatty acids that it needs every day for proper optimal function.
Let's move into type 2 diabetes. That's going to be the main focus of our topic today. And I want to read to you what I wrote in the show notes. So you're a doctor. You can tell me if I have this wrong at all, and I'll correct it before it goes out in print. But I said of type 2 diabetes in the show notes today, in my view, we should not even call type 2 diabetes well diabetes. I personally consider it a lifestyle induced insulin resistance.
Yep.
Type 2 diabetics are often producing more than adequate insulin than a healthy person needs. What happens is, due to overconsumption of sugar, carbohydrates, they become resistant to insulin, needing more and more to control blood sugar. Then the cascade occurs. More insulin creates more fat storage with even the same amount of calories, leading to more need for artificial insulin, leading to greater insulin resistance, back to more weight gain, and it continues. And that's what I think we're dealing with. It's not even, like, we call it diabetes because that's the result, but it's not really diabetes. Like, diabetes is, my pancreas can't make insulin. That's a horrible thing. It affects about 5 to 10%, depending on whose numbers you believe, of diabetics that exist in the country today. The rest are type 2. And I have to couch this with, I've heard from one or two people that have made a pretty good case that, like, it's something that can happen without bad diet. But in my opinion, that's exceedingly rare. That's a unicorn.
Yep. That's not going to happen. It's because you know very well, Jack, that the words you use matter very much. Like if I say the word liberal, Well, okay, that may or may not mean anything, because my definition and your definition and the guy listening's definition may be completely different. Because if I talk about that, I'm talking about the classical sense of liberal. But most people today, they don't even know there's a classical versus a modern definition. And so the words you use to describe medical conditions like type 2 diabetes, that sounds like something you got genetically. Maybe, who the hell knows? I don't know. Maybe I had a viral infection. But when you call it what it is, I'm a huge proponent of calling things what they are. Let's call it chronic carbohydrate overdose syndrome. Because
I like that. I like that.
You immediately know what caused it, but you also know built into the definition is the solution. Oh, okay. So if I'm a crack addict, what should I do? I should smoke less crack until I stop. Yes, that's right. If I have chronic carbohydrate overdose syndrome, what should I do about that? Avoid saturated fat? Mm-mm, not in the definition. Nope. Should I eat more fruits and vegetables? Mm-mm, not in the definition. What condition do you have? What should you do about it? It becomes very simple when you call it what it is.
See, and I think they call it type 2 diabetes because it makes people immediately accept the solution of take this pill.
Yep. Right. 100%. Yeah.
And like so that's the whole goal. Sell more drugs.
Yeah. Well, and I don't even, that's not the whole goal of your average doctor at the average doctor's office. Let's be very clear. I think at the very higher levels of the pharmaceutical industries, there's 100% profit driven conspiratorial thinking going on. 100% agree. But at your local doctor's office, there's none of that. Your doctor's just trying to get by and pay the electric bill and make the Mercedes payment and put his kids in. I mean, he's just trying to get by. She's just trying to get by. But what they wind up doing is not thinking about what they're doing. And that's very dangerous. And as you know, I know people who've lost legs, who have kidney failure, who are blind because they were just given idiotic advice about type 2 diabetes from their doctor, along with a handful of pills and injections. And I think that it's very clear that pills and injections do not reverse type 2 diabetes, but there is a way of eating and a way of living that does reverse type 2 diabetes effortlessly, cheaply, and permanently. And when you think about that, what the hell is your doctor doing? It makes many people question the entire industry of medicine. And you should question it. But your doctor's not part of this big conspiracy. Your doctor's just doing the best he can. If you came to see me back in 2003, I would have said you need to eat more whole grains and stop eating the honey buns. You need to get off the couch and move. You need to eat lots of fruits and vegetables. We always say it that way, don't we? And you need to take these two pills. That literally would have been what came out of Dr. Berry's mouth back in 2003 because I was an idiot. I didn't know better at that time. Now I know better, so I have to do better and I have to teach better. And that's what I'm on a mission to do.
You know, I agree with you that doctors are not generally part of this grand conspiracy. I say they're the result. Mm-hmm. The pharmaceutical companies drive the training that the physicians receive. And, you know, no one gets heavily successfully sued and put out of business or has their license revoked or anything like that for following protocol. Right. So right. You train the protocol and then you enforce the protocol. And then, the doctors, you know, hand out the protocol. Yep. So I don't think they're part of it as in they're in on it so they can gain. I think they're the result of it. Just like if I trained, you know, young children to be, you know, jerks, then they're the result of my training.
That's right. And I think doctors are dupes just like the patients. But there's a difference because the doctor, number one, should know better. And number two, the doctor doesn't suffer the egregious complications that come with uncontrolled type 2 diabetes. The patient is the one that's going to suffer. And so I can't tell you how many doctors and nurse practitioners and physicians assistants and pharmacists we have in our private Patreon group who are like, because once they do get this, once the paradigm literally shifts in their head, they're like, holy crap. It's actually fun to practice medicine again. It was such a drudgery before because it was literally prescription pad. Here's some pills. Next patient. Here's some pills. Next patient. Here's some pills. And every time you saw the patient 6 months later, they were fatter, sicker, more miserable, and more consigned that I'm screwed. My life is going to suck for the rest of my life. But when a doctor learns how to de-prescribe and how to actually talk about a diet that is sustainable, that you can actually do, that's not going to break the bank, that's not going to, you know, you're not going to have to be food prepping for 7 hours a day to get your food ready. You're not going to have to drive 3.5 hours to that one grocery store that has that that special berry from the Himalayan mountains. You just eat meat and a little bit of veg, and all of a sudden, it's fun to practice medicine, because when that patient comes back in 6 months, their A1C is better. They've lost 20 pounds. They feel better. They're sleeping better. Everything's going better in the bedroom, if you catch my drift. And it's like, dude, I love you. You're my favorite doctor in the world, because you're actually, I can see benefits in my life when I follow your advice. Whereas all the other doctors I've ever seen, I just got fatter and sicker.
So let's talk a little bit about this docuseries. I want to hear how you got involved with it in the first place, but I also want to just kind of pull one thing out of it that I picked when I watched most of it yesterday. There was a point in it where you were talking to the, I guess the guests, the participants, the patients, call them what you want, the people that were there to reverse their diabetes. And you asked them, right? And these are people with serious medical problems. Has any of your doctors ever said to you, my goal for you is to get you off of insulin and healthy again? And not one of them said yes, that they had never heard those words come out of the mouth of a doctor. And that, I knew it, but it's still watching it, it kind of hit me like, damn, like we're really killing people here. Like you're not upholding your Hippocratic oath. You can't be. You might be a dupe, but you're still not doing it. Yeah, all these people doing this shit.
I mean, whether you kill somebody intentionally with malice aforethought or whether you kill somebody accidentally, they're still dead. 100%. And I think, you know, if you're in the legal realm, they understand that very clearly. But I don't think a lot of doctors understand that. If you're giving bad medical advice and people are suffering irreparable harm and dying prematurely, that's your fault. Yeah. And so I think a lot of doctors have never considered that either. And they see one of my YouTube videos and they're like, holy crap, I never say that to my patients. Maybe I should look into this, because that, first of all, would be an amazing thing to be able to tell my patients truthfully. And once they've watched a few videos and thought about this a while and maybe went back to their old physiology textbook, looked a few things up, they're like, holy crap, this does work. This will work. I'm going to start recommending this. And then all of a sudden, not just that one patient who kept bugging them about keto, but now all of a sudden, Jack, every single patient they see every day is getting better advice.
Yeah. And it is a cascade that reverses the original cascade. How did you end up involved with this docuseries? Did they reach out to you? Was it like a casting call? How did this all happen? And also, what made them decide to do this in Costa Rica? I mean, that's a cool place and all, but it had to add cost of production and things like that.
Yeah. And so Charles Maddox, he was the third producer that reached out to me and said, hey, I've seen your YouTube videos. I want to make a documentary or a movie about this. The first guy just disappeared. Never heard from him again. The second guy, I was sounding pretty good. And I'm like, okay, yeah, let's do this. And he's like, okay, I need 80 grand up front just to cover expenses. And I'm like, no, I'm going to give you the information. I'm not going to pay your bills. And so I guess there's a production model of profit out there where the guy pays them to basically make a movie saying whatever you want. I was like, yeah, I'm not interested. Have a nice day. Then Charles popped up. So Nisha and I were both skeptical, like, oh, another producer. Okay, this ought to be good. But he stuck with it. He kept saying, no, we're going to do this 100%. And the reason we went to Costa Rica is because he felt like we had to have some beautiful background scenery. He had to get the drone shots. It's got to be, you know, visually appealing or people are not going to watch it. That was his opinion. I may or may not disagree with that. That's irrelevant. But I think the information is so groundbreaking. We probably could have shot this in my backyard and it would help just as many people. But I'm not a producer, am I, Jack? So I just shut up and stayed in my lane and taught these people how to reverse their type 2 diabetes, which they're all actively still doing. I'm in contact with all of them and they're all doing great. And so that's why it's in Costa Rica. And I wish that we'd spend a little more of the budget on promotion instead of travel. But again, I'm not a producer. But it was a great experience. And Costa Rica is definitely a beautiful place. I'm happy that I got the experience.
So the one of the things I wanted to make sure that I got through to my audience today was that we are talking about reversing type 2 diabetes.
Yep.
But you know, when I looked into keto, I figured out that there are people who have reversed cancer by going on keto diets. And then my takeaway from that was, well, if you can end up with a cancer and you can go to keto and basically starve the cancer of sugar and take the cancer away, then maybe by going keto, we don't get cancer in the first place, at least some types of cancer. Well, maybe that applies to type 2 diabetes. And I want people to understand the depth of this problem. First of all, every number I'm going to give you is from the CDC. I know you know these, is for the audience, right? Every number I'm going to give you from the CDC, but the number's going up every year. There are an estimated 35 million diabetics in America. Only about 5% of those are type 1, people who were born with the curse. That I think a lot of that 5% wants to kick the shit out of these people who have given it to themselves, right? Because they don't have the option to just make it go away, right? That means we're looking at like 32.5 million people with type 2 diabetes.
Just in the U.S. alone.
Just in the U.S. And this stems from obesity, right? And some people look really obese and some don't, but it's obesity is what causes it. Obesity itself is killing 600+ thousand people a year in this country, many of them through diabetes, or they'll say not diabetes wasn't the cause, it was kidney failure. It was kidney failure from freaking diabetes, right? So that 32 million number that keeps growing, the other side of that is there's a lot of those people dying every year, and there's more than enough new diabetics to replace them. We now have children in their teens with type 2 diabetes. Yep. Even like, I'm sure you remember, you're about a little bit older than me, right? Like back in school, there was probably the fat kid in your school, right? Like one, right? Yep. And now like it's the fat kids. And it's, this is this, for all the talk of pandemics, this to me is the modern Western world pandemic. It's obesity. It's diabetes due to obesity. It's cardiovascular damage due to obesity. And I think one thing people need to understand is people like you can help them reverse a lot of this, but like once you do physical damage to your heart, that damage is there forever. You can stop the damage, but you can't make it go away. Like we were talking about me busting my tendon earlier. How do you fix a muscle when it's busted? You rest it. You don't have that option with your heart. Like people need to take control of this now because your future is written if you don't.
That's right. 100%. And so, yeah, you talk about the millions of people with type 2 diabetes. But what about the millions of people with pre-diabetes, right? Because there's absolute unarguable research truth that if you have pre-diabetes, you're doing damage just as much as if you had type 2 diabetes. You're damaging every tiny artery in your body, the arteries that feed your eyeballs, your other ones, your heart, your liver, your kidneys, your toes. Everything hinges on the health of your arteries. What about all the people who have pre-diabetes or type 2 diabetes and are not diagnosed because their idiot doctor doesn't know to check a hemoglobin A1C and a C-peptide, right? What about all the people who are misdiagnosed as having type 2 diabetes who really have type 1? You and I know a guy that was diagnosed as type 2 diabetes for 7 years because his idiot doctors.
Yes.
Multiple doctors, because he had type 2, he was taking the medicine, his blood sugar was still 400 every day. And he would go back to his doc and say, "Are you sure I'm not type 1? The doc's like, "No, you're 40, you're type 2.
You're too old." Yeah.
You're too old, right. This guy suffered all the damage that was done every day for 7 years. What's 7 times 365? That damage, like Jack alluded to, is permanent. This guy is trying now. He finally found a doctor, got diagnosed properly as type 1, and is taking charge of it with a ketogenic diet. But all that damage, you can't take that back. And he's furious. He should be. That some of those
2,555 days.
2,555 days, he was having microscopic amounts of damage for every single one of those days. If that doesn't piss you off, I don't know what can even get a rise out of you. This has got to stop. And I'm hoping that Reversed, this docuseries, is going to be the thing that's the tipping point that makes every patient in the world, when they go to their doctor and say, "Look, doc, I don't want to just manage this. I don't want you to give me another pill. I want to reverse it. I saw this television show that says you can reverse it. I want you to help me reverse it. How do we do that?" And either the doctor says, "Oh, yeah, I've heard of Dr. Barry. Let's do this." Or they say, "You can't reverse type 2 diabetes. What are you talking about?" And the patient says, "Idiot, go watch Reversed. And then you, too, can be a good doctor."
Yeah. And I think one of the things that we have done by calling this a disease rather than a health issue is we've made people think binary, right? So like I either have cancer or I don't have cancer. I don't have I guess you can have some precancerous skin cells or something, but in general, I don't have precancer. I either have the flu or I don't have the flu. I don't have the pre-flu, right? I'm either infected or I'm not. Well, diabetes isn't like that. Diabetes type 2, which is really carbohydrate overdose, right, is like a dimmer switch. So if I take a dimmer switch and I've got this light over my head here and I turn that up, doc, just a little bit and that light's on really dim. And I say to you, is that light on or off? You say the light's on and you're correct. But a doctor looking at an A1C that's slightly elevated says, oh, you're pre-diabetic.
Yep.
Well, no, you're diabetic. You're just not as diabetic as the person he just saw that had to like limp in with their foot ready to be amputated. You're still diabetic.
So diabetes, type 2 diabetes is a spectrum. And a lot of doctors, they're first of all, they're trained to say this. So it's, again, it's not the conspiracy. But if your hemoglobin A1C is under 7, they will tell you, literal quote, that's fine. Keep doing what you're doing. I'll see you in 6 months. That happens hundreds of thousands of times in doctors' offices around the world every single day. That is dangerous advice. In my opinion, that's malpractice. If your doctor says, your A1C 6.9, good job, I'll see you in 6 months. But that happens every day, Jack. That's not rare. That's super common because the American Diabetes Association trains doctors that as long as you can get their A1C under 7, you're a good doctor and they're doing a good job and nothing bad's going to happen. That's terrible advice. Even with a hemoglobin A1C of 5.6, which is normal, there's still a little bit of damage being done. The research shows without any kind of equivocation that the lower your A1C is, the longer you're going to live, the less damage you're going to have done. And so I tell people, yeah, 5.6, awesome. You hit a triple. Now let's go for the home run. Let's get it even lower than that. That's where you live a long damn time. You outlive all your enemies. You wind up with all the toys because everybody else who had the toys has died and you're the only one still alive.
You know, let's move into a little bit about how not only eating the right food, but things like intermittent fasting. And I daily intermittent fast. It's not even a plan for me anymore. I just eat my lunch really late, my dinner fairly early, and I don't eat any other time. And if I want to have a snack on a given day, I eat in between. Right. And that's just the way it's been. Perfect. But we've been talking about how the alleles extend, you know, in your cells. And it basically is a turning back the clock on aging. And it made me think of something I saw a long time ago. And these two people seemed like complete loons to me. And they were. But I think it might be the same reason that what they were saying worked. It was like on 60 Minutes or 2020 or something like that. And it was these two people. And they were eating mainly plants. But they were eating a very, very restricted diet. And they did not look healthy. But their claim was it would extend their lives. Yep. And the actual science behind it, living at the edge of starvation, was they tend to live longer. 100%. They didn't look healthy, but yep. I'm feeling like the intermittent fasting and that have that similarity in that by going without food, it's causing the body to basically burn all the things out of you that need to go away. And if you're constantly shoving food in your hole, that process never happens. Even if you look thin and you seem relatively healthy and your numbers are good, you're not cleansing, you know, the things that become cancers. You're not cleansing the old dead cells that need to go away because your body's never put in a place where it's given, I guess, a positive form of stress, yep. where it says, hey, take this time, cleanse this shit out.
Yep. Yeah. So, and there's lots of research in rodent models, rats and mice, in dogs, and even in monkeys, that if you calorie restrict them, basically just semi-starvation for the rest of their life, they live longer, 100%. But here's the problem. The paradigm is wrong, in my opinion, because if you're calorie restricting this animal, what else are you restricting? Carbohydrates, right? 100%. And secondly, in order to semi-starve them, you got to lock them in a cage, because just like we said earlier, if you don't lock them in a cage and semi-starve them, they'll break out and they'll go eat. So you got to keep them in a cage. And Jack is exactly right. The people who are maybe the 1/10 of 1% of people who can actually starve themselves for years, they're very rare, but also they're very skinny and they don't look healthy. They don't look happy because they ain't happy. It sucks to starve yourself, right? And so just imagine if you're like, okay, I'm going to starve myself for the next 20 years. Who's going to do that? Nobody, except for that one weird guy that nobody liked in school. He might do it, but nobody cares if he, you know what I mean? It's ridiculous. But the problem with all this research is now people are actually, now that low carb is becoming very popular, they're going back and saying, you know, you were also restricting carbs. So was it the starvation, or was it that you were just restricting carbohydrate intake? That maybe is what made them live longer. And you cannot tease out which one it was from the research they did the way they did it. A ketogenic diet is a fasting mimicking diet, meaning that all the hormones mimic, they go to the same place that they go to when you're fasting. Now, obviously, fasting is more powerful as a fasting mimicking thing than keto. But most people, if they're eating enough fat in the ketogenic diet, they're just naturally going to start fasting. You're going to start skipping breakfast, or you're going to start skipping dinner because you're just not hungry. It's easy to fast if you're not hungry.
And we had a question come in, Doc. What is a good A1C?
So, okay, let's talk about A1C. A perfect A1C is about 5.0, okay? And you're going to be able to get that on a super, super low carbohydrate diet. If it is 5.6 or lower, that's considered, that's the official cutoff for normal. If it is 5.7, you're pre-diabetic. And that is an arbitrary cutoff. There is no research that shows that a 5.6 is way, way better than a 5.7. Basically some old white-haired guys in white coats got in a room and voted and said, okay, let's make it 5.6. That's the cutoff. So between 5.7 and 6.4, you're pre-diabetic. Now, is somebody with a 6.4, are they doing much better than somebody with a 6.5? No. That's just an arbitrary cutoff, okay? And so if you've got a 6.5 or higher, you are a type 2 diabetic currently, or you suffer from chronic carbohydrate overdose syndrome. And so the instant that you start cutting back on carbohydrates, not cutting back portion size, you're going to get rid of the carbohydrates and you're going to eat more fatty meat. You're going to eat more bacon, more eggs, more avocado. That you eat to your full on keto. That's one of the beautiful things that makes it so sustainable, is you never walk away from the table hungry. If you do, that's your fault. It ain't my fault. Okay. Because I told you to eat to your comfortably stuffed. Your hemoglobin A1C is immediately going to start to come down. Okay. And the more you restrict the carbs, the faster it's going to come down and the more completely it's going to come down. So if you start, you can start with a hemoglobin A1C of 13, which I've seen. It's very dangerous, but it happens. When you start to cut the carbs immediately, it's going to start to drop. In 3 months' time, you can have your hemoglobin A1C of 12, 13, 14. You can have it down to 7 or 8. Another 3 months, you can have it down to a 5 or a 6. Okay? It literally, within 6 months, somebody with the highest hemoglobin A1C you've ever heard in your life can have a normal A1C. And that is the definition of no longer being a type 2 diabetic.
Mine wasn't that bad, but I went from a 5.9 to a 5.1.
So you were pre-diabetic. Right.
Pre-diabetic.
And now your A1C is lower than probably 95% of the adult population in the United States. Well done. And so people might be saying, well, okay, I changed the number on my lab results. Big whoop. Well, what Jack did in the background in his physiology is he cut his risk of having a heart attack in half. He cut his risk of having a stroke in half. He cut his risk of kidney failure by probably 95%. He cut his risk of losing a toe or losing a foot or a leg by probably 99%. He cut his risk of having diabetic retinopathy and going blind by 99.9%. All of these things that happen to diabetics, they don't happen because you have this diagnosis of type 2 diabetes. They happen because of what's going on in your physiology on a daily basis. Yeah, Derek reversed. He look at this. He went from a hemoglobin A1C of 8.8 down to 6.2 in 8 weeks, 2 months. He knocked over 2 points off of his A1C with keto. That's how it's done. Well done, Derek. Now it's time, Derek, to keep it going till you get under 5.6, and then you're going to start teaching your friends and family. Well done.
So let's talk a little bit. We have one question here, alcohol consumption. Let's do the short answer on that, because the short answer is you ain't burning fat when you have alcohol in your system, nope. Right?
Your liver has to prioritize getting the alcohol out of your bloodstream because, listen carefully, everybody, listen up. Alcohol is poison, okay? You understand? There is no alcohol that's not poison. Now, do Jack and I have a drink every now and then? Hell yeah, we do, because we like it. But do we in any way delude ourselves into thinking, oh no, it's red wine, it's very good for my heart? Bullshit. Okay. That's stupid. Stop saying stupid things like that. Alcohol is poison. If you want to have a little poison every now and then, that's totally fine. But you need to be honest with yourself and say, I love this really old bourbon. It's so smooth, but it's bad for me. It's bad for my liver. It's bad for my kidneys. It's bad for my brain. But I'm going to have a drink anyway because I'm an adult and I can make that decision and I'm going to do it anyway. Alcohol is never healthy, number one. Number two, alcohol is never beneficial, ever. I don't care what they said on WebMD or CNN. That's horse shit. Let's be very clear. So with that being said, if you're going to have an occasional drink, have gin, vodka, whiskey, and mix it with something that has zero calories and zero carbohydrates, and enjoy that in very strict, rare moderation, and it's fine. But do not delude yourself into thinking that there is any beneficial effect of alcohol whatsoever, because there ain't.
And I would add, in my personal experience, when you're far from your target weight, don't.
No,
just don't. When you're in that loss mode, you're going to set yourself back. You're basically giving up for two drinks, 2 days.
Yep.
That your body is going to get thrown out of whack. You're going to have a couple hours of it in your system.
Yep.
You're going to have about 48 hours before your body starts burning fat again. I can prove it with my own weight loss records in Excel. And you can see where I had a couple, three drinks, and you can see exactly what happened. And the steady weight loss went away. The next day you actually will go down a little bit because you dehydrated yourself. And then when you'll come back up, and it takes a couple days to start that steady track down again. It just happens. I'm sorry, guys. I wish I could tell you it doesn't, but neither one of us are going to lie to you. The other thing, you're talking about portions too. Like, I think especially as you get into a 2-meal-a-day regimen, or some do one, I'm not going there, but 2 meals a day, you really don't have to worry about your portions at all, assuming you're sticking to true keto. We're not trying to make keto gumball lasagna balls or some stuff, right? You know, and almond flour, everything and all, like real keto, you don't have to worry about it. And this is why I love your term proper human diet. There are no obese animals. Now, people will look at an elephant or a hippo. They're exactly the way they're supposed to be.
Yep.
And obese carnivores.
The only time an animal in the wild ever is obese is if they have access to human trash.
Correct.
So they're basically eating our diet. But otherwise, an animal in the wild eating their species-specific diet, no matter how much food there is, they are never obese, ever. End of story.
And as someone who's gone into ecology a lot, this idea that it's because there's only so much food, they don't have – no. If a lion wants another wildebeest, a lion's going to get another wildebeest.
They're right there.
Right? They look for the stupid and the slow, and they go knock one out like really quick. So they eat as much as they choose to eat, but they're eating their proper diet. But now we take the lion and put him in a zoo. And then we supplement his meat with basically kibble. And we have lions that are, 13-year-old male lions that have freaking diabetes.
Right.
We have dogs with diabetes, Ken. Like, and what is the dog eating?
When you're eating a species-specific diet, it hacks your hunger hormones and it hacks your satiety hormones so that it just turns your hunger off. And that's why, I don't know if any of you guys listened to my podcast with Jack several months back, but I challenged Jack. I said, Jack, I will pay you $500 if you will eat all the beef, butter, bacon, and eggs. No condiments, only salt, water, beef, butter, bacon, and eggs. You can eat 15 times a day. You can eat 15 pounds of it a day. I will pay you $500 if you can gain 20 pounds doing that. And Jack didn't take my bet. Not that he's game. He's grown up. He'll stand up when he needs to, but he knows you cannot do that because the fat and the protein in that meat is going to turn off your hunger hormones and turn on your satiety or your fullness hormones. And at some point of eating that, you will be just like the lion. Even though there's more antelope laying right there you could eat, you get up and walk away because you're like, that's it, I'm done. I cannot eat another bite. I literally would throw up if I ate one more bite. That's how the human body works too, but we haven't been trained to know that because we're trying to eat all this high carbohydrate garbage that the American Diabetes Association. Have you guys ever went to the ADA website and looked at the recipes that they recommend? Like the average recipe is going to have 30 grams of carbohydrates per serving.
Because oatmeal is good for you, right?
A serving size is 1/10 of a teaspoon, right? So you need to, you have to eat it in moderation. And you're like, what the hell is wrong with you? But they're like, don't eat red meat. Don't eat saturated fat. You know, don't eat too many egg yolks, but eat this high carb meal. And we are the American Diabetes Association, and we're here to take care of you.
No, thank you. No, thank you. I've gone to about 95% carnivore. If I eat any vegetables, it's raw greens and things like that. You know, I've just found it easier. And our disagreement about calories is I know most people when they go keto, they start counting carbs. They don't do what you're saying. Right. And they're bringing these other things. And I'm like, you're dealing with an addict. And if you don't put that addict on portion control and you're going keto that way, they're going to overeat.
Yeah,
but if you're even realize you're not going to freaking overeat, you can't do it. It won't happen.
Yep, and I think
you might for a week, but Jack's you won't exactly sustainably right. do it, right?
Yep, I think Jack's exactly right for some people. Other people, and so that also let's talk about this. It's very important to do keto right. You got to count total carbs. You do not count net carbs because the keto is becoming very popular. Slim Fast is in the keto market, right? Weight Watchers is going to be in the keto market before long, or they're going to go broke. All the big guys are now they've got keto bread. They've got keto this, keto that, keto cake, right? Keto peach cobbler. But they, if you look on the front, it'll say only 2 grams of net carbs. And then when you turn the package over, it's like, oh, it's got 27 grams of total carbs per serving. And a serving size is 1/10 of a cup. Okay, so they're not counting fiber, but what they don't tell you is that soluble fiber does break down into some degree of carbohydrates. Some of the soluble fibers, you get 2 grams of carbs per ounce. And they don't tell you that. And so you think, oh, I'm only eating 2 grams of carbs. No, you're actually eating 27 grams of carbs. So you're not even eating a low carbohydrate diet, even though it says keto on the front of the damn package. But yeah, if you cut the carbs down low enough, you cannot overeat. You cannot overeat. It is impossible unless you're some kind of a glutton for punishment or you've entered the hot dog eating contest at the fair and you're overeating for money. Maybe then you can do it. But on a daily basis at your house, you're never going to overeat meat. It is impossible to do.
Well, and I think the net carb debate has gotten really great over because what kind of net carbs are we talking about? Are we talking about the net carbs from a sweet pepper?
Right.
You know, or lettuce or cabbage? Because the fiber in those is highly indigestible. A little bit of it can maybe be converted in your lower intestine. That's also it's a biointensive process. So your body tends to only do it if it needs it, kind of like it does with protein. Now, if you're talking about extracted wheat starch, they've pumped into a tortilla or a solo bread or whatever. Like, tapioca, if you have something like that once in a while, it's probably better.
Yeah. So tapioca fiber, oat fiber, corn fiber, wheat fiber, any of those fibers you see, 100% there's carbs in those fibers. You're going to break them down in your small intestine, not in your colon, and you're going to get carbs out of those. And so, yeah, I tend to agree with Jack. And if you go watch some of my YouTube videos from 3 years ago, I was saying you can trust the net carbs. You can trust broccoli, okay? You can trust collards, but you cannot trust it if it comes in a plastic bag or a cardboard box because they got a profit motive. They're going to lie to you, but broccoli will never lie to you. And I agree, you can count net carbs if the only carbs you're eating are real vegetables.
Whole foods.
Yeah. But still, most people find it easier to just count total carbs and get on with it. And then also, Jack touched on something that most people, after a while on keto, they just tend to gravitate towards carnivore because you feel better, you look better, your A1C comes down even faster, your weight comes down even faster. It's super quick and simple and easy. You just throw it in the skillet for 3 minutes on each side and then scarf it. You don't have to eat it on a tiny red plate. You don't have to turn off the TV and have dinner with your family. None of that horse shit that the Harvard School of Public Health tells you means anything if you're eating an improper diet. And it also doesn't mean anything if you're eating a proper human diet. You can literally eat with a cafeteria tray piled up with beef ribs in front of the TV, lock your family in the bedroom, eat with and have a big glass. And you know what I'm saying? All those little things like, oh, eat small portions. All that stuff is horseshit. If you're eating a proper human diet, you don't have to worry about any of that.
No, that I agree with. And that's what I think the debate comes in. What are we talking about becomes so ever loving, important. You know, last night I had vegetable matter, a very small amount of, I made some cauliflower rice, some fresh caught white bass, and my doctor would have had a heart attack, right? If he would have saw what I added to that, cause there's not much fat in the fish. So I threw a whole stick of butter in the pan, a bunch of chopped sage and garlic, and made a sage brown butter sauce and drenched that fish in it, cause the fish has almost no fat.
Right.
And I ate that. That was 6:30 last night. It's 12:09. And I haven't not eaten today because I'm punishing myself or because I had an early interview with you. I'm not hungry. I'll have to make myself eat about 3:30 so that I can eat my dinner early enough to do this again. But I'll have to but when I went carnivore, or mostly carnivores, when that happened, and I would say people that think the 2-meal-a-day thing isn't going to work, do 3 carnivore for a week.
Yep.
And then you're just going to find yourself at breakfast going, and the first day you think, I don't really need to eat, but you're eating out of habit, don't, and watch what happens. And it will go so much faster than if you're, you know, I love all these keto channels because they're getting the brand out there. But if you're trying to make all kinds of like keto noodles and keto pie and all this stuff, even if it works, it will work so much slower. When I see people go carnivore, it literally just falls. And it's because the hormones balance. One of the most brilliant things I ever heard you say, Ken, was when you said, if I have an 18-year-old boy and an 18-year-old girl standing in the distance and all you can see is a silhouette, right? And they're both healthy, about the same height, the right around the same weight because they're young and thin. You can look at that silhouette and say, boy, girl.
That's right.
What told that girl's body to put a little bit more fat on the hips and on the breasts and be a little more curved? It wasn't the food she ate, right? Assuming she's eating good food. It's her hormones.
Right.
And so those hormones control and regulate our entire body structure and type.
Yep.
So if we fuck up our hormones, I'm sorry, but we're going to fuck up our bodies. That's just how it is.
100%. And so, you know, some people have a pear shape. Some people have an apple shape. Some people have their mesomorphs, so their ectomorphs or endomorphs. Those are all hormone control things. So your hormones absolutely control where you store fat, but they also control how much fat you store 100% of the time. And eating a high carbohydrate diet mucks up your hormones. That's exactly how we have this obesity epidemic and this type 2 diabetes epidemics in the modern society, is we're eating too many carbohydrates, too many highly processed carbohydrates, and your hormones are completely and utterly confused. All they know is that there's so many carbs, I better store more fat. I better store more fat. My insulin level's chronically high, therefore I'm storing fat everywhere. And that's how you wind up with people who have fat hands and fat forearms, which literally should not be possible if you're eating a proper human diet. The only way you can start to literally put fat on your forehead, if you've ever watched My 600-Pound Life, this happens.
Yeah. Yes, it does.
Up your hormones enough by eating such an improper diet, you can actually put fat on your feet and your hands and your forehead, places that we aren't even designed to store fat. But more dangerously, you're also storing fat in your liver and in your pancreas and actually in your heart muscle and actually inside your tongue and inside your kidneys. Fatty tongue is one of the main causes of sleep apnea. And a lot of people, they've got sleep apnea and they're not even overweight. They're slender, but they have sleep apnea, and it's because, for whatever reason, their body just genetically stores more fat in their tongue. They go carnivore after 6 months. They're selling their CPAP on eBay because they don't need it anymore, because they reverse their fatty tongue. They reverse their fatty liver, their fatty kidney, their fatty heart. Even fatty lung is a thing if you're eating too many carbohydrates for your personal biochemistry. All these things get better immediately by eating a ketogenic diet and doing some degree of daily intermittent fasting. And also you can reverse type 2 diabetes by doing that.
You know, when I did this, I was about 5 or 6 months into it. And one thing I've always been proud of is the build of my legs. I was never a guy in the guy that's in there with the big biceps and he's got the bird legs. I've always had big, strong legs. And my legs, even when I was fat, seemed like, well, at least my legs are lean. And I'm sitting on the couch with my wife and I just start rubbing my thigh and I went, what the hell? And I'd realized I had lost weight even there.
Yep.
And so like you're saying, you can have this intermuscular fat anywhere and you don't realize it until your body starts to burn it. That's what, and I can attest to the snoring. I used to shake the house. I, you know, unless I am completely wiped. Like if I do a 16-hour day and I just hit the bed, and that when you hit the bed and you instantly go out, I don't snore hardly at all anymore.
Yep, same for me. I used to, Nisha used to have to wear earplugs when we were first dating in our first year or two of marriage. And now after, so even on carnivore, I still snored a lot, right? But now I don't snore hardly at all. At least that's what my wife, who sleeps in the same bed with me, reports. But the only time I'll snore is if I'm, like Jack said, completely just blasted, exhausted, and I've got a little bit of irritation, like I've got a little cold or something, then I'll snore for a night or two. But on a nightly basis, I don't snore at all. And I'm 52 years old. I'm way younger than Jack. But I just don't snore anymore. And there are so many guys listening to this going, that's stupid. I'm 50, I'm 60, I'm 70. I'm going to snore. No, not necessarily.
So we have a question from Larry here. I know exactly how you're going to answer this. But how do I get my antioxidants without fruits and veggies?
So Larry still believes, just like I believed when I first started this nutrition journey, that there's magical phytonutrients in plants that you can't get anywhere else except by eating lots of colorful leafy plants and these berries and these roots. That's all horseshit, Larry. And so here's the thing. Look up glutathione. You actually make it in your body every day. It is the most powerful antioxidant known on the planet. And you make more of it if you eat more fatty meat. And so glutathione trumps every other antioxidant you've ever heard of in your life that this guru or that plant-based nutrition guy was talking about. All those antioxidants cry and run home to their mama when they come up against glutathione. So I eat lots of meat to get antioxidants. That's how I get that.
And I'll add that, like, if you really want to boost your nutrient, include organ meats in your diet. And my way for doing this is I'll get a liver, like a whole beef liver that's from a grass-fed cow. I'll freeze it, because if you don't freeze it before you do this, you'll hate yourself. And I'll put it through the grinder, and I'll make little 1/10 ounce packages of it and put it all in the freezer. Yep. And when I take out a pound of ground beef, I take out 1/10 of a pound of liver, and I mix that in there in those burgers, and it makes them fantastic. Because I would love to be the guy that says, I love to sit down and eat liver. I do not. But when you mix it in hamburger meat or sausage, I don't know what it does, but I think it's probably just triggering the fact that you know you need it. But we're not lions that eat the liver out of the paunch, right? So, except for rabbit liver. If you can get your hands on some freaking rabbit liver, that's like the most fantastic food on the planet. But just blend it in with your foods, and there's so much nutrient. There's nothing more nutrient dense than a grass-fed cow or a wild analog, an elk, a deer, something like that. Nothing even comes close, especially if we use the whole animal. We start rendering bone marrow. We don't throw away the freaking fat and trim it off. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, no fat leaves my home without being consumed. If it's too much fat for the dish, we render it, we put it in a jar, we label it, we cook with it. If you're doing that, you're not nutrient deficient, period. It's a lie.
Yep. 100% agree. So yeah, rabbit liver, chicken liver, and cod liver. Those are the three livers that I can eat and somewhat enjoy. Now, when Nisha makes chicken, she fries chicken livers in bacon grease. She breads them with pork panko and Parmesan cheese. Dude, I can eat those all day. Okay. Those are delicious. But when it comes to pork and beef liver, I don't love them. But Jack's exactly right. So what I do is I take 70-30 gram beef, and I use 2/3 that, 1/3 beef liver, and just grind them together. It makes the most amazing hamburgers in the world, and you're getting more phytonutrients, because actually if the animal is grass-fed and grass-finished, they actually have phytonutrients in their meat. I've got a study on my desk I haven't read yet that actually says, oh, yeah, actually you can get phytonutrients without eating plants if the animal was actually pastured properly and treated and respected like an animal should be. But I don't love a lot of liver, but I know I need to eat some liver at least twice a week.
Yeah. Yeah. And by the way, what you just said about frying the chicken livers, my fish fry for keto is half of the pork rind grinds and half Parmesan. And then just per cup of each of those, a tablespoon of pecan meal, because it binds it. And you can make a fried fish, and people don't believe you when I tell them, well, that's diet food. Yep. And fry that shit in bacon grease, man. Like it's really not, like, this is all easy, you know? And I think people are trying to overcomplicate it. I've noticed the first thing I see in, like, online support groups, how do I make keto bread? And it's like, just don't. Just don't. Even if you're going to eventually do it, like for your first 60 days of initiation and detoxification, you're going to rehab. You don't even get narc, or what do you call it? Methadone, right? You don't know. You're cold turkey. You're off and your life will be easier. I always do try to prepare people for what we call keto flu, though. My wife gets pissed off at me. You know, we'll be talking to somebody that's really overweight. The conversation comes up. I'm like, you know, I used to be over 280 pounds. And they're like, what'd you do? And I told them keto. Like, I've heard about that. And I always expose them to the possibility that in that first month, like I had zits that looked like little mini boils come out on me. I had rashes. I got freaking gout. I'm freaking 47, 48 years old when I was doing this. I got freaking gout. Like, what the hell? But I think if you don't know that can happen, then you're like, oh, like I feel bad, so keto must be bad. Well, if you were a heroin addict, to go back to that analogy, when you stop taking heroin, you're going to feel like shit. That doesn't mean you need heroin to fix the problem.
That's right. Yeah. And I think making the keto breads or buying the keto breads, it's just like somebody who's just went to rehab for alcohol, right? And they just got out of the program and they're like, hey, can I have near beer? Is that okay? O'Doul's? Because there's no alcohol. It's like, dude, what are you doing? Why does that need to still be part of your life? That's not something you should even be thinking about. You maybe need to go back in the program for a couple of days. Because if you think you need near beer, O'Doul's, or some alcohol-free beer for your life to be complete, then I don't think you understand the lessons they were trying to teach you in rehab. The same goes for keto bread. If you think you need bread, you haven't broken the carbohydrate addiction. You're trying to have a simulacra of your bread so that you can still have your bread and not suffer the consequences. And that usually does not end well.
No, your bread is now two leaves of romaine lettuce, and put whatever the hell you want from an animal with a face in between them and eat that. Like that's what your bread is. And here's, I think, another thing. Like I've noticed, like, if I come off the wagon and I start drinking a little bit, if I drink two nights in a row, it takes two nights in a row. It's a habit. And now I want another glass of wine, or I want another whiskey or whatever, because I had one last night. I had one the night before. But that works the other way. We want to eat bread because we have a habit of eating bread. We want to eat rice because we have a habit of eating rice. We want bread because, hey, how easy is lunch when you throw some meat between two pieces of bread?
Yep.
If you start doing it with something else, even something you're not in love with at first, give it a week or two. It'll become a habit and you'll start looking forward to it. It's amazing what happens when you do that.
Yep. I totally agree. Totally agree.
So let's talk about your book a little bit. It's been out a long time. I love the title, Lies My Doctor Told Me. And we've talked about how doctors are kind of dupes in this. They're not in on the scam or whatever. However, that's a pretty direct word, lies. And you have a reason you chose that word instead of like misconceptions or why my doctor's stupid. It's why my doctor's lying to me.
Yeah. So if your mechanic says, oh, Jack, you need a new transmission. And in reality, you don't really need a new transmission, right? But the mechanic's going to make money by selling you this new transmission. Now, is your mechanic, are they hurting your car's performance by selling you a new transmission? No. It's going to run fine. So they didn't really harm your car, but they profited from a situation that you didn't benefit from. Does that make sense? Right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So you go to a doctor and you're like, hey, dude, I've been peeing a lot. And he checks your blood sugar and it's 250. He's like, oh, shit, you got type 2 diabetes. If your doctor, the thing that should happen is like, oh, you want to reverse this? Okay, keto and intermittent fasting. Here's some YouTube videos to watch. Then guess what? You don't go back to that doctor. You might go back in 6 months to just confirm that you did this right. But then you're not going to every 3 month appointments, are you? But if you follow the doctor, he's like, here's the American Diabetes Association website. They got tons of recipes. Follow that. Here's a couple of prescriptions. I want to recheck your blood work in 3 months. Now, all of a sudden, you're going to the doctor 4 times a year for the rest of your life. And so there's the profit model for the doctor. And you have to go to the pharmacy once a month or every 90 days. There's a copay for the pharmacist. And you're frequenting the ADA website. You're trying all these recipes for this pudding and that pie. And your blood sugar is just getting worse and worse. You're getting fatter and fatter. Do you understand that the doctor is financially benefiting from advice that does not help your health? The ADA is benefiting financially from advice that does not help your health. And the pharmacist is benefiting, and the big pharmaceutical corporations, and the big food corporations, because they're selling you the shit to make the ADA recipes. everybody's benefiting and your health is suffering. And it all comes from the advice that you got from that doctor. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but doctors have a fiduciary duty to their patients. This is a legal term. And what it means is effectively your doctor becomes your legal parent in this situation. And that's why doctors don't get to have sex with their patients. They don't get to get in financial tangles with their patients. They have to give medical advice, and that has to be it. There has to be a barrier between these two people in that relationship, or the doctor is taking advantage of that relationship, right? So this fiduciary duty means that a doctor has a duty to first and foremost know what the hell he or she is talking about. That's their duty. That's their one job as a doctor, is to know about the care and feeding of human beings. If they're not doing that, then they're failing in that fiduciary duty, aren't they? And so then when they give bad advice, it's more than just, oh, it's a myth. Oh, he misunderstood. Oh, it's misleading. That's where I come from in the South. That's a damn line. That'll get your ass whooped when people find out that you've just been giving this terrible advice. And maybe you didn't know it was bad advice, but you also didn't go to the trouble to figure it out. That's a doctor's damn job, is to, if you're giving advice, you better damn well know if it's good advice or not. Just like a mechanic, or if a hairdresser says, here, Jack, put this stuff on your hair. It's going to make your hair, and your hair falls out. You're like, what the hell? I'm going to sue your ass, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But it never occurs to a patient after 20 years of bad advice from a doctor, and they've lost a toe, and now they're in a wheelchair, and now they're on dialysis, and now they're blind. It never occurs to them, maybe I was just getting shitty advice for 20 years.
Maybe I'm at least somewhat responsible for this, right? I mean, that's, you know, absolutely, because your patient did what you told them to do, right? I mean,
that's right. And most doctors, they secretly think, because none of their patients are getting better, right, with this advice, they think, oh, they're just laying on the couch eating Cheetos and ding-dongs. They're not following my advice. Wake up. If you're a healthcare provider, yeah, they are following your advice. They're having fruit juice smoothies every morning for breakfast. They've switched to whole grain bread they wouldn't touch.
And they may stop taking your advice, but it's because your advice didn't fucking work, right? So they're torturing themselves with your advice. Nothing gets better, so they go back to eating a bagel with a schmear, right? Because why am I bothering to do this when it doesn't work? Yep. I want to give a shout out to Hayes Anderson. This might be the best comment I've ever had on a nutritional podcast ever. He says, if you have a moral issue with eating animals, try eating fish. Fish are dicks. All they do is eat other fish constantly 24/7.
And shit in the water. Yep, that's all they do.
Well, they have no choice on that one, right?
Yeah. But now, if there happens to be a vegan watching, in all seriousness, please start eating oysters and other shellfish, okay? Even if you can't bring yourself to eat an egg because the chicken was raped, or you're eating a chicken period, or all the stuff I hear vegans say, I'm being very honest and very blunt. Start eating shellfish. They do not have a nervous system. This is known to science. They cannot experience pain. They do not care what happens to their babies, but they are a literal nutrient-dense superfood. Making that one change as a vegan, your brain will light up. Your skin will start to look better. You will start to look younger. You will start to be healthier with that one change alone. I don't have a problem with vegans. I think they're wrong, but I think they're at least trying to do something, which is more than we can say for a lot of people, right, Jack? But
absolutely.
If you make that one change, start eating oysters, and then I love the, just start eating the asshole fish. Those two things, you will reclaim your health by doing that.
Well, and like the Paleolithic evidence on the shellfish is huge. I got really deep into ancient civilizations over the past year, deep research, and it turns out everywhere humans settled that we can find remnants, we find these huge mounds, and they thought these mounds originally were like burial mounds and whatever. Well, they are burial mounds for the houses of shellfish. There's massive, I mean, huge piles everywhere humans settled, because before we screwed up the groundwater, if you found a piece of, if you found a freshwater mussel or whatever, anything you found anywhere, you could eat it and you weren't going to get sick. Yep. Like we screwed the water up, and since they filter feed, you got to be careful where you get them from. But yeah, I agree with that. This has come up a bunch of times, Ken, in this today. But Tyler's asking, what effects does keto have on high cholesterol? This fits the perfect with your lies doctors tell us, because if my cholesterol is over this little number here, I'm going to die. And it's bullshit, isn't it?
Well, and so first of all, the research shows that's actually been done in low carb and ketogenic diets that about one third of people, their cholesterol will go up on keto. About one third of the people, it stays the same. And in about one third of the people, it goes down. That's what the research is currently showing. So I'm one of those people, when I eat keto or carnivore, my total cholesterol, it's probably, I haven't checked in a few months, but last time I checked it was 350. And my LDL was about 250. Now, a lot of people, including a lot of doctors, are still freaked out. Like, holy shit, your total cholesterol is 350? Dude, you're going to die. Well, here's the problem. All the research that doctors talk about that make you fear total cholesterol being high was funded by the companies that sell cholesterol-lowering pills. I shit you not. There is no independent research that has ever been done on the face of the planet Earth that shows that having an elevated cholesterol does anything harmful to you. The only thing we can prove it does is that you live longer and you don't have cancers often if you have high cholesterol. A couple of the independent studies showed that you have less heart disease with a higher cholesterol. I shit you not. Now, LDL cholesterol, there might be a tiny bit of evidence that shows that it might be a risk factor. Might, right? But here's the thing. If you consider, okay, you got high blood sugar, you got a high A1C, you've got high triglycerides, you've got low HDL, that's a shotgun, okay? Having high LDL is a BB gun. Now, I come into Jack's house and I get Jack down on the floor and I say, Jack, I got a shotgun and a BB gun. You're getting shot with one of them. You pick which one you're going to pick. If I had a choice, I'd get up and whoop your ass. But if I didn't have a choice, then I would take the BB gun because that's not a big deal. But I definitely would not want to be shot in the head with the shotgun because that's the end of me. That's what having type 2 diabetes is. That's the shotgun. Having high triglycerides, that's the shotgun. Having a high C-peptide, that's the shotgun. Having a high LDL of 250 like mine is currently, that may or may not be getting shot with a BB gun. I'll take that all day over being shot at point blank with the shotgun.
Well, and none of these studies going all the way back to like the 7-country studies, everything that's ever been done in between to try to prove this hypothesis. And let's be honest, it's a hypothesis. It's not even a proven theory at this point. Never isolated out. Well, what about people that have higher cholesterol, but they have higher cholesterol because they live on predominantly a meat-based diet and they don't eat donuts? Like, if you, like anybody that actually understands the way they taught you the scientific method in like 6th freaking grade, right? If you don't control the variables, then the science is junk, and they have not controlled the variables. If you were testing for a hypothesis that high cholesterol equals heart disease, you would have to take out the other variables. Like, nobody with type 2 diabetes should be in your study.
Yep.
Right. You should only be looking at people that are otherwise healthy but have elevated cholesterol. And I promise you, if you're getting your cholesterol from whatever Crisco the Krispy Kreme uses, you probably are going to have many health problems, and they may or may not be because of your cholesterol. Also, what damage are you doing to yourself? Like, in our arteries, if we have an amino acid called homocysteine at elevated levels, it damages our arteries. Cholesterol sees the damage and it tries to repair the damage. That's what it's supposed to do. It fixes shit. It builds your cells. Well, if you don't have that damaged artery, then you're not going to have the problems due to the cholesterol, right? And what is your biggest thing to knock your homocysteine levels down? B12. Where do we get that? It's almost like this was all designed for what we were supposed to do in the first place, isn't it?
Yeah. It's almost like there's a proper human diet, and when you eat it, bad shit doesn't happen way less often. But if you don't honor the principles of a proper human diet, you get fat, you get type 2 diabetes, you suffer, and you die prematurely. And sometimes if you've been eating that improper human diet for long enough, it makes you wish for death because your current life situation sucks so much that death would be preferable.
Yeah, yeah. So let's make sure we get people in touch with everything that they can get Ken Berry related. If they've been under a rock for the last 5 years and don't know, you have like 1.7 million YouTube subs or something like that. So like half the damn country seems to know about you already. But let's talk a little bit about your YouTube channel. You put out content on a really regular basis there, don't you?
Yeah, I try to put out at least three new videos every single week. And since I'm a family physician, I'm broadly trained. So I talk about lots of things from mental health to gout, to psoriasis, to PCOS. I literally try to talk about everything that a family physician would have a patient come in and have that problem, because that's how I was trained and that's how I make YouTube videos. And so if your teenager has acne, I got a YouTube video about that. If your grandfather has dementia, I got a YouTube video about that. Literally, there's not many medical conditions that are common that I don't have either 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 YouTube videos about, hitting from different angles, so that the regular person who's just works at the grocery store, drives a truck, or just, you know, you don't have to have a PhD to understand my YouTube videos. I try to put it in just regular folks' language so you can walk away from that video and go, okay, I understand the problem, and I understand immediately what I can do to start reversing the problem today. That's the goal of every YouTube video I make. And then every Monday night at 7 p.m. Central, my wife Nisha and I do a complete hour of nothing but question and answers. And sometimes last night we had 3,000 people watching. And we literally just rapid fire for that hour. We answer as many questions as we can, because people are hungry for knowledge. They're not hungry for bullshit. They've had enough of that. They want, okay, yeah, what do I need to do right now? And that's what I do on YouTube, is try to help people answer that question.
Yeah, and you did a great job of it, man. Let's hit this one more, and then we can cut you loose. I know we've had you a little over an hour here. Alice says, what about our brains on keto? Now, I've seen research done where, and they're using MCT oil for this, but they're taking dementia patients, and they do a brain scan, and you see the dark part of the brain where nothing lights up, and they feed them sugar because that's supposed to be brain food, and the dark spot in the brain just doesn't do anything. And they give them a couple tablespoons of MCT oil. It's pure fat, yep. And it's probably one of the better fats we can get from plants. And yep. You see that area light up. Now, it doesn't make them better, but clearly it's the only thing that's causing that dead part of the brain to actually come back and do anything. And to me, again, I'm back to, I'd rather prevent a thing than try to fix a thing. And if something helps fix a thing, then it probably prevents the thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. Kids with autism, kids with ADHD, kids with OCD, kids with obsessive compulsive disorder, older folks with even the earliest signs of dementia, keto is the way for every single one of those human beings, because your brain can run very inefficiently and very dirty on sugar. But your brain absolutely thrives on ketones and fatty acids. So the research is very clear on this. When you get past the big pharma industry funded studies and actually get to the independent research, it's very clear. Just like Jack said, your brain lights up when you eat a ketogenic diet. When you eat a proper human diet, your human brain actually prospers from that.
Can we hit one more before we go here? Jake, because you know Jake. Jake just needs to eat all carnivores, what Jake needs to do. He says that he had a TIA, transient ischemic stroke, no damage based on his MRI CAT scan. His doc is prescribing statins, some word I can't pronounce, some other word I can't pronounce. He says it's an insurance against the future stroke issues. Is this legit? Would you do it, Ken?
The lisinopril, which is an ACE inhibitor medication to lower your blood pressure, Jake, might be a little bit of insurance if your blood sugar is still high, because you're currently still eating too many carbohydrates. I haven't seen Jake lately, so I don't know what his diet looks like. But the clopidogrel for a year or two after the TIA might be a little bit of an insurance policy, but there's no research that shows you should take it longer than a year or two. And then the statin is just foolishness. There's zero research that shows that that's in any way brain insurance whatsoever. You can throw the statin in the garbage right now.
Cool. Well, I'll make sure, Ken, that we have links to your YouTube channel, the docuseries, your website, all your social media stuff that I can find in the show notes today. And I really appreciate you being with us. And I want to tell you, like, when you think of doctors that save lives, we tend to think of surgeons. The neurosurgeon that operated on my wife 15 years ago, that man probably saves a dozen lives a week, but you've probably saved more, because this is something that people can do. They can do it for themselves. They don't even need to go out of doctor's office. If they just freaking listen to you, or they listen to crazy duck farmers like me and do this, they can literally not even step in a medical office. And 3 months later, you don't need, I think you should get your labs and all, that's good, But you don't need to know that you're feeling better. You don't need to know you have now you have sensitivity in your feet when you didn't. You know that's a good thing, right? You don't need to know that you started taking your blood pressure, you're on medication. You had to start throwing away blood pressure pills. You don't need to know from a laboratory or from some doctor who's maybe still following the status quo that you're doing better. You feel it. And man, thank you for all the work that you've done and just being tireless on it. Oh, we need to hit real quick. You're going to be here, right? In just a month and a half, right? What are you going to be talking about at TSP 21?
I'm not sure yet.
That's why you're the only freaking person on my schedule that just says Ken Berry.
Yeah, I'll let you know when I get there.
All right. I bet it's going to have something to do with the stuff we're talking about today, though. And if you're coming, you're going to get to meet Doc if you haven't already. And if you were here last year and you told Doc about all the good things you're going to do and you're coming back and you didn't do them, you're ready for an ass kicking. And that's another thing I love about you, Ken. You tell people like it is. But the other thing I've noticed about you is you seem to have something that I've tried to develop over the years. And it goes back to my military time. And I don't think you're in the military, but you have this anyway. Some people need it one way and some people need it another way. And a true leadership is being able to know, how do I need to put it to this person? Because some people need to be told, look, you're so fat, you're going to die. And if you don't do something about it, you're going to die. And some people need more of a gentle, and I watched you do it with different people, different ways. And I appreciate that too. But man, thank you for being with us today on a live feed. And for those that are listening to this, maybe you caught it later. This video will be on YouTube as long as they don't take it down. They probably won't take this one down. And it will go out in the audio podcast feed about an hour from now.
Love it. Thanks so much, Jack. I'll see you soon.